met him first, say, in 1929, through the intervention of a friend of mine, common friend, who asked Mr. Gandhi to see me, you see. And so Mr. Gandhi wrote to me, saying that he would like to see me. So I went and saw him. That was just before going to the roundtable conference. And then he came to the second roundtable conference, didn't come for the first. And he was there for about 5-6 months. And there, of course, I met him also and faced him also, you see. Then, at once thereafter, he also, after the signing of the Pune Pact, you see, asked me to come and see him. So I went to see him. He was then in jail, you see. But that's all the time that I have met him. But I always say that as I met Mr. Gandhi in the capacity of an opponent, I have a feeling that I know him better than most other people because he had opened his real fangs to me, you see, and I could see the inside of the man, you see, while others who generally went there as devotees, you see, saw nothing of him except the external appearance which he had put up as a Mahatma, you see. But I saw him in his human capacity, the bare man in him. And so I say that I understand him better, you see, than most of the people who have associated themselves with him can say. Gandhi has already vanished from the memory of the people in this country. His memory is kept up because the Congress Party annually, you see, gives a holiday, either on his birthday or some other day connected with some event in his life, and has a celebration every year going on for 7 days in a week. Naturally, people's memory is revived. But if these artificial respirations were not given, I think Gandhi would be long, long forgotten.
You don't feel then that he fundamentally changed the aspect of...
Not at all. Yeah. Not at all. In fact, he was all the time double-dealing. He conducted two papers, one in English, the Harijan, you see, and before that, Young India. And in Gujarat, he conducted another paper, you see, which is called the Deen Bandhu or something like that. Now, if you read the two papers, you will see how Mr. Gandhi was deceiving the people. In the English paper, he posed himself as an opponent of the caste system and of untouchability, you see, and that he was a Democrat. But if you read a Gujarati magazine, you see, you will see him a most orthodox man. He has been supporting the caste system, the Varnashram Dharma, and all the orthodox dogmas, you see, which has kept India down, you see, all through ages. The people, the Western world only reads, you see, the English paper, where Mr. Gandhi, in order to keep himself, you see, in the esteem of the Western people who believe in democracy, was advocating democratic ideals, you see. But you got to see also what he actually taught to the people in his vernacular paper. Nobody seems to have made any reference. All the biographies that have been written of him, you see, are based upon his Harijan, you see, and the Young India, but not upon the Gujarati writings of Mr. Gandhi.
Then what were his real intentions with regard to the scheduled castes and the structure?
Well, he only wanted, you see, there are two things about the scheduled castes. We want untouchability to be abolished, you see. But we also want, you see, that we must be given equal opportunities, you see, so that we may rise to the level of the other classes. Mere washing off of untouchability is of no consequence. We have been carrying on with untouchability for the last 2,000 years. Nobody has bothered about it, you see. Nobody has bothered about it. Yes, there are some some disabilities which are very harmful. For instance, people can't take water, and people can't have land, you see, to cultivate and earn their livelihood. But the other things which are far more important, you see, namely that they should have the same status, you see, in the country, and that they should have the opportunity to hold high offices, so that not only their dignity will rise, but also they will get what I call strategic positions, from which they could protect their own people. Mr. Gandhi was totally opposed. Totally opposed. You see?
So you would say Gandhi was an orthodox Hindu?
Yes, he was absolutely an orthodox Hindu. You see? I thought he was never a reformer. You see? And he has no dynamics in him. You see? All this talk about untouchability was just for the purpose of making the untouchables drawn into the Congress. That was one thing, you see. And secondly, you see, he wanted that the untouchables should not oppose his movement, you see, of Swaraj.
And then do you think that political independence would have come without Gandhi?
Oh yes, I'm sure about it. It might have been in slow degrees. But I personally myself think that if Swaraj had come in slow degrees in India, it would have profited the people better. You see? For each community or each group, you see, which is suffering from many of these disabilities, you see, would have been able to consolidate itself at each stage of the transfer of power from the British. You see? Today, the whole thing came as a flood.
Was it Gandhi who was too impatient, or the Congress party? Was he?
No, personally, I do not know how suddenly Mr. Attlee agreed, you see, to give independence. That's a matter of secret which Mr. Attlee one day, I think, will disclose in his autobiography, how he came to do that, you see, because nobody ever expected, you see, such a sudden change of front. Nobody ever expected. But it seems to me, from the analysis that I make about it, there are two things which I think led, you see, to the Labour Party to take this decision. One is the National Army that was raised by Subhash Chandra Bose. The British had been ruling this country in the firm belief that whatever may happen, you see, in this country, and whatever the politician may do, you see, they will never be able, you see, to change the loyalty of the soldier. That was the one prop on which they were carrying on their administration. Now that thing was completely dashed to pieces, you see, when they found that even the soldier was being seduced, you see, and to form a party or a battalion to blow off the British. Then I think the British came to the conclusion that if they were to rule India, the only basis on which they could rule was the maintenance of the British Army. Going back to the year 1857, when the Indian soldier rebelled against the East India Company. And they found that it would never be possible for the British to supply India with enough European troops, you see, to keep their hold on it. You see, secondly, I have no evidence, but I think the British soldier wanted the disbandment of the army immediately, so that they wanted to go to their civil jobs. You see, how much indignation there was at this gradual disbandment of the army, because those who were not disbanded felt that those who were disbanded were going to take their jobs. What's going to happen to them? You see, therefore they could not, you see, think of having enough of a British army to keep India down.
He worked entirely as a politician.
As a politician. He was never a Mahatma, and I refuse to call him Mahatma. You see, I've never in my life called him Mahatma. He doesn't deserve that title. Not even from the point of view of his morality. You see?
Please like, share and subscribe our channel for more updates.